I didn't really taste this one.
No. Tastes the same as yesterday. Just a little bit more expensive because it's nearly gone.
Hello, Flint.
Hello, Sam.
And welcome to the studio. You released two EP on Abstract Reflection.
Yep.
And correct me if I'm not into the good accents. It's Sincere.
Sincere. This is from France.
From France.
It's the wine. Sincere is the place in France. I made it because the main sound, this like sound, comes. I bought a bottle of Sincere, the wine, and the box was corrugated, like I don't know if you know what corrugated is. You know, like
called
this corrugated is like this shape, where it's not flat, but it has loads of tiny bumps. Yeah, and I got the credit card and I run the credit card along, like when you have a railings and you have a stick when you're a child and you on the gate.
Yeah,
this sound, but like this on this box. And I have my credit card, and brrr, it sounds nice. So I record it, and then it's brrr, I like this. How can, and then I put socks in the box, and then it's different sounds. Brrr, and I record many times different things in the box with my credit card, and then I make the beats from this.
With
the box
socks.
From Sincere.
Okay.
Yes, this is why I've called this
Three
track this.
Socks.
And socks.
So it was a...
Act like a filter.
2014.
Yes.
And then just before it was Daniel.
Yes. Day zero, the first, maybe the day after the Big Bang, the very first day of creation.
Okay.
Day zero.
Oh.
The first day, day nil. Nil means nothing, yeah.
Irrational Media Society Explode Vinyl.
Yep.
Which is with a very nice artwork.
Oblique Burial.
The Blood Box from the kaer-uiks record from Daniel, our friend.
Interference.
Also the Cowmetry record.
Mm-hmm.
The Nerve of Time, a series of remix, like the Lejak Roll Funken you did.
I did this one. I did one on Abstract Reflections for a French guy. I need to think of the fucking name now because my mind's gone blind. He's going to kill me as well if I don't think of this fast. Legasgred. I don't know if this is how you say it. Legasgred. Anyway, he's on the Abstract Reflections. I've remixed him. And I have 1, 2, 4 vinyls out on self-released label Interact Records.
Yes, including the one that is just on my desk, right?
Yes, that one.
I'm curious about your when you're coming from,
mm-hmm.
because you looks like you're in fact a real musician, if you can
real
yeah. can be like this. So what is your first instrument?
So I started playing guitar when I was about 13. My uncle was in many bands as a musician when he was younger, and he gave me an electric guitar. And obviously most kids, you know, something about an electric guitar is a bit more prestigious than a classical guitar. You know, you feel like a rock star. And I didn't know how to play it, but he didn't even have any strings. But I used to pose on the bedroom floor like, And anyway, of course, that made me want to learn. So I remember I bought my first guitar. It was like a maroon Squire Stratocaster from a shop in Bromley. And I taught myself. First of all, I actually had a lesson. And at the time I was a young teenager into heavy metal and Slayer and stuff like this, and I went for my lesson and she sat me down and, I had long hair and wearing all black. And she's like, "Kumbaya, my lord, kumbaya." And I was like, hang on, man. I'm wearing a Slayer t-shirt, So I ended up just teaching myself in the end and yeah.
Yeah, and guitar, electric guitar is already a foot inside sound because it's more versatile than the acoustic one maybe. Mm-hmm. And you can already find searching for different sound yeah. than the other guitarist, like maybe I will plug it with this kind of amp and this kind of pedal.
Immediately I had pedals, exactly, yeah. The Boss pedals, and you learn the different sounds, the different yes. distortions and the delays. Yeah, I suppose. Things.
So what was your first electronic instrument?
The MC Roland MC303.
Oh yeah.
Yes, I bought it because it was a complete workstation, and I knew I could write whole songs on it. It's the sequencer plus the synthesizer all in one, and I didn't know too much about how electronic music was made. And at the time, I'd sort of into industrial and a bit of trance in the early days, and I was intrigued about how this sounds was made, but didn't really have any idea. And this is one machine that I could afford at the time within my budget. So I got it. And at the time, I think I pushed the limit, the machine to its limits. I really could get some crazy stuff. And because it's the only thing I had, I was really fast navigating my way. And I swear I probably made some sounds that maybe Roland didn't even know was possible. But the more and more pieces of equipment you get, unfortunately, I don't know every single piece of equipment I have now as well as I did that machine, because if I did, then I'd probably be really good.
Mm-hmm. What was the first companion you chose for the 303?
Well, because we used to write music, me and Dave, my best mate, we used to be Flint Kids together. I had that, and then he bought a Korg Trinity, and we used to and then he bought an MPC 2000, and I bought an Akai 6000, and those are the four pieces of gear we had for years before we got computers, and we just used to MIDI them up and do the sequencing largely on the Trinity, as the main Trinity synced with the MPC 2000. But it was a pain in the ass because you're just staring at a small screen of tiny little blocks that mean nothing, and yeah, very difficult.
And you were already thinking for playing live? How was the...
Not at all. We were lucky because we met a guy called Lee, who's a really good friend now. And we got together and we decided that let's put on some nights in London. So there was an old toilet down Commercial Street called Public Life. We put on some nights there, and they were really successful. And pretty soon, every single one was a sellout. And we ended up moving in the end, put on a few nights at Corsica Studios, which is obviously now really successful in Elephant and Castle. So, of course, we put on nights, and then we pay for artists that we've always really liked and respected. This is where I met ADJ and CFAX Acid Crew and people like this. So we book in these artists. But of course, because it's our night, we can put ourselves on the same bill. So I thought this is a good introduction, We go on first, get some experience, play some music, and then, some of our heroes get to play on later. And then slowly, we found our way out of the bedroom and into onto the stage. Mm. Sort of made it ourselves, yeah, gave ourselves that opportunity early on to be able to do that.
So in your experience, is there a kind of difference between the British scene and all the more continental European scene in terms of your own experience with the public? Is there a different kind of mood or reaction?
To be honest with you, I've been massively impressed whenever I've gone away. I was really impressed with Romania, and I'm sure you were as well. The sound system was great. The venue was great. When I played in Germany, just with, well, with Daniel and the people at Complex 23, is it? Yeah, Complex 23.
Yeah.
And when I played with the Scribble lot, I mean, there's some crazy creative people. And yesterday, my mind was absolutely blown with the creativity of people in Toulouse. So I know there's pockets of people and collectives really trying to do great things all over Europe. And I don't think it's any different in London than it is anywhere else, to be honest with you. I think you just have to hunt it out, look for it.
Yeah. So, yeah, you're speaking about your show last night. We are back from Toulouse, and you were playing in a kind of complex which is for art and experimental things, and it's the south of France, so it's my near to where we are actually. Mm-hmm. So how do you find the people and the venue and all the stuff? What is
it? Totally exceeded my expectations, and it's not something I can just say lightly. Like, I had no idea what the gig was going to be like, whether I was going to go somewhere, it's going to be 50 people, it's going to be a small club, not a clue. And I turn up and there's a nice warm welcome, and there's people, you know, the smell of solder in the air and people making electronics and, you know, Pure Data and Max MSP open on computer screens, and the smell of spray paint and people painting, and everything is like a beehive of activity going on. And immediately I thought, yes, this is the place for me, you know. I like this, and weird sounds just like out of nowhere, and I thought I could move in, I could come and live in Toulouse. So yeah, it was just an immediately great experience, and I'm sure I'll go back.
Yeah, definitely, you're welcome here in the south. And you know, the cloud was there, the rain was here too.
Yes. I know, I didn't get any sleep.
Next time the summer is gonna be here, promise. So I want to get back into more your composition way of working. Mm-hmm. And how do you begin a track?
It does differ every time, and there's no one fixed rule. But generally, it didn't take long for me to learn that I can't just sit down and turn on the computer and go, right, I'm going to make a song and start doing it straight away like this. I realised that I have a few processes. One can be a quite relaxed process where I can have a few beers, get a bit stoned, just make some sounds, have some fun with the machines, have some fun with the software without having to have a goal, you know, just let's just make some noise. And I always record all this noise, and then later on, whether I'm still a bit drunk or stoned or I'm sober, I choose all the bits that I like the best and think, okay, I can work with this, put them all in folders, so that when I have a good mindset, usually in the morning, wake up, coffee, sensible brain in the studio, and then I have a folder of sounds that I've already hand-picked as the best ones, and I can work with something, whether I put those in a sampler and map them on a keyboard, or and then I'll choose the best of those sounds and just start playing around with different combinations, see if I can get something going on. And usually, you know, I'll end up blending two sounds, three sounds, I get some little rhythm, find something, and then from then on, every sound inspires the next one, and it will almost write itself. And
yes, it's kind of magic.
Yeah, I'm almost powerless. It just pulls me in this direction and says, this is what I am going to become. As source sounds usually go, there's nothing I prefer than just making random noises with anything, whether it's just simply playing around in the cutlery drawer like we have many a times with stuff from the kitchen, or just anything, contact microphones, multiple microphones, mid-side, just as many different ways. Like I was talking earlier about a cup, you know, trying to like from this ting to the sine wave that then could be mapped on the keyboard. Like you say, once, you know, rolling it around, so it goes brrr, like this, rolling it this way. And then when you think, oh, I can't get any more sounds, throwing it against the wall and having the smash. And then you get in every last sound you can out of an object, or and then using this as my organic source material, and then maybe putting it in Max MSP and fucking it up, or, you know, dragging it into contact, randomizing all the time, just trying to destroy it as many ways as I can and see what sounds can be made from that source, and then again putting them in folders and then using those to start.
So how can you, explain me your way? You destroy things. It's obtained sound, and then it's a creating process.
I must say, in ear display, these guys, Thomas, is his name Thomas? Cut it if his name's not Thomas, but I think it is. He makes some, yeah, it is, because he's friends with Keepers, who's also Thomas.
Yeah.
Thomas Hennebert, maybe I'm not pronouncing your name wrong, sorry.
Thomas.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Makes some fucking good plugins. And I use his many, when I talk about destroying stuff, as many times as the in-ear display plugins.
Okay.
I know this is a plug. I don't get paid by in-ear display, but there's some good plugins.
Maybe you have one thing to save, one thing to put in your bag and get out.
It's the laptop, yeah.
Yeah, the computer and the microphone.
Yes. My sound card, obviously, which has to be for the microphone.
What kind of sound card are you using, actually?
The RME UFX. Well, I saw you play, obviously. I was at a stage where my motor was coming towards the end of its life, and I knew I needed... I was looking to get a new computer with a new operating system, and I knew that the Motu was years behind now, so I need a new interface so that I've got a system that is at least going to last me another 10 years or something. And then I saw you and how compact and feature-rich RME was. And I did some research, people saying, yeah, I prefer it than Apogee, and this converters are good, and the preamps are good, and it's zero latency monitoring, and everything I read was good. And I bought it, and not thinking that the difference could be actually much, but it was night and day for me, the RME compared to the Motu. I love it.
Mm.
It's a really great, great sound card.
Speaking about the software you're using, what are you into actually, for generating sound or for destroying? So be a bit more specific on the software you're...
Yeah, so like I say, in-ear display, the glitch machines, multiple plugins from loads of different companies. I've probably got more plugins than I need, but a lot of the time I could just create my own racks in Ableton. Obviously, you can get a lot of joy out of randomization, like I was saying earlier, because you can just press a button and all the parameters randomize, and you can see what it sounds like, and then it could be a starting point that's more interesting than just an initialized patch, you know. You know, normally if synth, if you start from the default or something, it might just be a sine wave. But if you start from a preset, sometimes it actually will give you, you find the preset that's closest to what you're looking for, and it'll give you somewhere to start from. And it's the same with using the randomization technique or whatever. Obviously, I'm in love with Max. I'm not, certainly no guru, but I can navigate my way around it enough to be able to make some patches to do some fun things and to make some sound. But obviously, this is an ongoing love that I'm sure will continue for many years.
Do you find there is in our present a lack in something is missing in the current technology we are all using, and something you would like to arrive one day or another, new things?
Not necessarily, because if anything, sometimes I give myself limits, because I have hardware and I have a lot of software and a lot of plugins. Sometimes you could switch on a computer and you could have so much, and you could just go like, where do I, you know, there's so many options, where do I start? So I give myself boundaries. So like the latest song I've done, my idea was to just use delays, whether it's using different speed LFOs syncing to the delay times, or reversing a sound, putting a delay on it, reversing it back. You know, short delays like Hass style to like massive long delays that sound like... Basically doing as squeezing every last inch out of delays, and then just trying to make a sound all out of these, song out of these delays. So I gave myself a boundary, and then it was easier for me to focus on a direction rather than just have to use loads of different sounds. And one thing that, to actually go back to your question, I like the idea of bridges, like when Ableton joined forces with Cycling 74 and they did the Max integration. I love the fact that this is two companies that are not fighting for a place in the marketplace, but coming together and trying to make something better. And a selling point for me, which if anyone asks me, oh, I want to get into music, it's not just because I use Ableton, I suggest Ableton. But for me, because it comes with Max, if you would, you know, if you can only afford this one thing, all you need is Ableton and Max MSP. I mean, you could write music for a million years.
I read a thread about production technique. Don't you think that it's really depending on the creation process and the primary material using to create? For example, it is far more easy to make sound great a bit if you're using sound banks that are already
really well produced,
recorded. In the opposite, if you're using your own mic and trying to do bits with a part of
I totally know what you're saying.
Pure synthesis of sig like this. So obviously, for example, you were speaking about the Autica.
Oh, no, I say that I am a massive, obviously, like one of my favorite electronic artists of all time. But all I was saying, if you're talking purely about fidelity, a large soundstage, clarity, I just think that there are better artists that do that better. Not necessarily do the creation process or do the. But I'm talking purely about polished production.
Yes,
I don't. Yeah, I don't.
Isn't because they are using just only. Generated synthesis.
Yeah, possibly, but that was never my question. My question was ever just like what. My original question was, and the reason I asked it is to find out what people consider, because in any one genre, you know, if it's sort of unanimous that, you know, Tip is this guy or whatever, it's always nice as a reference point, because, you know, reference is the most important thing, not in terms of stealing styles but in terms of. You really quickly lose any perspective about what something sounds like if you listen to it even for 5 minutes, unless you then flick to a tune, you A-B and you swap and you listen to someone else's song and then flick back to yours and you go, ah, yes, mine hasn't got enough bass or mine's way too trebly. If you just listen on your own to your music all day long, you think it sounds great. But until you flick for something else and you go, whoa, mine's way too much bass. Because you need, and I like having many tracks to reference. Tracks that I really consider to be high standard,
Which one?
What? Which tracks do I reference?
From which artists?
Rob Clouth. Mostly, there wasn't too many surprises on the lists of people. Certain tracks I hadn't heard, like this guy Ben from the Zebra. This I don't know if it actually knows his name's Ben or Incanti Ben, but anyway, there's some cool dude from. America. He suggested specific songs by Tipper, which I hadn't listened to, which were pretty darn good. But people usually, I look for like balance or something. Like I said, I like Eskimo. I thought that was like a nice, rich recording of Cloudlight I've used. But it really does depend on the track. I try and get it as close to be the style. You know, I wouldn't A-B Fotech or something if I was doing a techno track. You know, I try and get the style as close, and someone that I know, no matter where I've heard this song, whether it's been in the car or it's been in a club or it's been on a record around someone's house in the lounge, it always sounds great. And I try and find that track. And then if you know that your song doesn't sound too different EQ-wise especially, then you're onto something that's going to succeed, at least sonically. But yeah, I totally get your point. What you were saying with Alteca, but nowadays that some of the plugins, like you say, come with such polished sounds that are ready to go. You know, you press a preset and you're like, woo, massive. Not the VST massive, but sounding big. Because I'm not a snob in terms of music production. I don't know if you heard my Gazelle Twin remix. You know this great female artist, you know, Gazelle Twin. I did a remix anyway. I did a remix for her. And for instance, you listen and it starts with I've got an electric toothbrush on a guitar. It's going grrrr on the strings. And then I make the notes, tune the notes on the guitar the same hum as the So you know the electric toothbrush goes, I tune the string, so make it the same, and then on the string, and then swell this into the beginning of the track, and then when it's the track, I've got loads of like mono recordings of different things, and loads of stuff like I normally do with recordings. But then I put some synth over it, and one of the main synth sounds, like I put it in first as a preset, yeah? And then no matter what I did afterwards, this preset sounds the best, yeah? So I just leave it. But I don't care that I've used the preset, because for me, the only important thing is to make the song as good as it can be. And for me, that time was that preset. Okay. So it stuck. So I don't care, because I know that I can make sounds, or I know that I have, but it doesn't bother me. The only thing that matters to me is what is best for this tune. By the way, I won at golf. He was a bit of a snake.
Snake. You play the guitar.
Yes.
And you're singing also very well.
And I won't let you fall as low as I've been.
Will we one day listen to some Flint song, or at least some guitar voice integration in some future project?
100%. For absolutely years, for about 10 years, I've been telling myself that I'm going to do an album of songs. other stuff, family life, children, careers, Flint Kids. You know, everything gets in the way, but I will... you give yourself excuses sometimes not to do something, maybe because you're scared of the reality of either having to do it or it not being well received. Maybe, I don't know, maybe this is what I've been doing all along. And but by the same token, I can't afford to go to a top quality studio week in, week out. I know I can make electronic music in the box or with my studio equipment at home quite well, but I can't A-B myself to, I don't know, Radiohead or Verb or whoever the music, Devendra Banhart, whoever the music is, and then ask myself, does my music sound as good as their music? And again, I'm not talking about songs, I'm talking about sonically. If they've been using, you know, amazing preamps. So it has been a bit about waiting till my home studio is good enough to do more real music, if you use that expression earlier. You know, have I got a decent microphone? You know, I know you could sing through an SM58, you know, into, like I say, the motor or something like this, but I want to at least know that when I do it, I have no excuses. And then if it's not good, it's down to the fact that I am not good at it, rather than being able to blame it on not having the correct gear, if it makes any sense.
So as you're playing real instruments, you was playing the keyboard this afternoon, mm-hmm. and it was a piano sound, and you were singing. So you understand the organic performance. Yes. How do you approach? What is your approach with electronic device? How do you play live? And what is for you? What is live music in the electronic area?
You know, it's a very difficult thing, because obviously this is the permanent struggle and something that I would love to do, but there's always a trade-off. So the people who are really having it, you know, like Tim Exile, Beardy Man, what's his name, Jamie Liddell, these guys, this is live music, okay? This is improvisation, this is people creating live electronic music. Or, I mean, you could have a number of people playing on synthesizers, or, okay, live modular jams. This is live. I mean, you might have pre-worked out a patch you're going to play, but people like Richard Devine and stuff, you're still doing it live. But the trade-off, a lot of the time, is... It depends if you're a perfection freak, I suppose. It's something I've probably actually got to lose, and I've got to enjoy the rough edges that I enjoy about organic music in the world of electronic music. Sometimes, I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. It's, you have to trade a certain quality and fidelity with more of a performance. And I think it's something that I really need to try and find the perfect balance between what I'm happy to put to play out live, and actually to, because there's nothing more I enjoy than sitting at a piano and playing, or playing a guitar and feeling the tiny nuances of a pitch bend, or, you know, just a tiny bit more pressure, or staying a little bit longer on a piano note to draw out that extra ounce of emotion. And if I can achieve that in the electronic world, then yeah, I would have obviously, but it's the never ending. I've changed my life setup so many times. I always want it to be less and less rigid, and more read the crowd, see what's going well, and be able to change depending on that. But then, like I discovered last night, it's not always about what the crowd wants, because if I was playing what the crowd wants all the time, then I'd have to be a techno artist and bang 303 to people all night to make them happy. There we go.
So it's about flexibility.
For me, yeah. Mm.
I find it like this also, and that's why I tend to do the more and the more generated synthesis, because of the flexibility. Mm-hmm. And yes, and the hardware for me is... even if it's a little amount, now hardware are such powerful that you can easily, because of the interface, being able to modify every kind of parameter, even if you don't touch it, mm-hmm. you know you can do it.
Yeah.
And it's the feeling that everything is flexible.
This is, I mean, obviously everyone will know that knows your music that you're a massive advocate of the Electron and the Octatrack especially. And this was the first actually bit of hardware I had where I really did have the feel of like a guitar or piano. When you map the crossfader to certain things, and just tiny little changes, and you can really get the feeling like you're playing an instrument, especially if you map it to the pitch and a bit more reverb, and you're getting nice bends, and you can play melody, like, and you feel like you're actually playing an instrument like a guitar or a piano sometimes with the Octatrack. It has that niceness about it. Do you agree?
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely. The 80s for us has been such a creative scene. Like, for example, in the British scene, the jungle, the trip hop, the big beat, and all this new style coming. What's happening since? What is your feeling about new music since the new millennium?
I don't know whether it's just nostalgia and the freshness of discovering new music when you're young, and this is what keeps you nostalgic. But some of it's taken a downhill. You know, I seem to remember decent music being on the TV when MTV first came out. You know, there was a lot of good music from Aphex Twin to, you know, Nirvana, and like a big range of decent, but not nowadays. It just all seems to me like my kids watch it, and I actually can't believe how bad some of the modern music, like modern pop music especially, is. When I don't know, outside of pop, obviously, like you say, people like Alteca and people like that have taken it to the next level, and Keyboardist, and obviously yourself, and Wolg, and count too many artists to mention. And so there's a lot of decent music, obviously, people pushing technology to the limits, but mainstream music, generally, I think, because people can create good stuff at home as well, nowadays you have to sift through the crap to get to the good stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, because it is more of a saturated market. You know, 20 years ago you couldn't produce really good things at home, but now people can make stuff, you know, that's listenable and palatable and at home. And because there's so much of it, putting it on the internet and putting it on the SoundCloud and Facebook and links on Twitter and Vimeo, and some people rush stuff out, and there's a lot of stuff that is really not a high enough standard. And then, but when you do get to the gold, it does stand out. Mm.
The big, the gold research, there is a name, you know, in the history when it was the time everyone's trying to get rich by finding a place where there is gold, like a river or
the end of a rainbow. Uh-huh. I don't know.
With some snake. speaking about releasing music. Mm-hmm. In this area, and with the internet and the 2.0 and the social and everything, do you think it's still something relevant to release an album or physical media like vinyl, CD?
Relevant nowadays, yeah. Obviously, vinyl's having a massive resurgence, isn't it? It's a very good thing.
Don't you think album, it's over?
I know we talked about this earlier. It's, I hope not. Like, I love listening to albums. Admittedly, I don't listen to albums as much as I used to, but maybe it's just the time constraints of being a father and things like that. But certainly, growing up, there's something about an album, it's in its entirety, and the journey, you know, it was never meant to be one track listened to on its own. And I know we live in this generation where people, you know, just want to flick from one song to another song. And like I was saying, with iPods having the shuffle or on Spotify, you know, people, it's too convenient for people to have a collection of music, and maybe they've even got it categorized in genres, in folders, and then they can just go like, oh, let's listen to some ambient, press play, and it'll just randomly pick from their ambient folder and give them that. But I love albums, man, and I really hope that they haven't died. But I do ask myself this same question: how relevant is the album for youngsters? Certainly, all the time we're still alive, it is relevant because we still enjoy it. Mm. But I'm not sure if album culture, because I don't know, you know, I'm 38, so I don't know what the average 20-year-old does in his bedroom anymore.
Yeah.
Apart from wank.
I think, in fact, we are music maker, and the former album was created by the industry. Mm-hmm. At the beginning. So it's our culture, because we discover such an amount of great music through album. But it was something to sell music, and maybe we have to think about...
Oh, yeah, I think the length of the format, this is what has changed. Yeah. Like you say, people are bombarded with information from all aspects, so their attention span is shorter nowadays. And I just don't think people find the time. Everyone's like, I haven't got time to do this, I haven't got time. People just don't sit there for 45, 50 minutes.
Yes.
Just listening, just taking it in, this album. Maybe if you're commuting, this is a good time to listen to music, put your earphones in. If you're jogging, whatever your thing is, you know, music on the go. But it's not the same. There's something about, especially in ears, I don't know, it's not the same as putting a record on or just sitting down comfortably like now, enjoying an album and not even feeling like you have to speak. You know, you don't, you can, you know, it's not important if there's not a conversation or if you're just sitting there, you know, having a sip of your beer or a smoke and just listening to the music for all its glory, you know what I mean?
Mm.
I love those times. Do you make, like, when you make music, do you make music for, with it in mind that people will be listening to it at home just for recreational listening, or do you write your music more with, I'm going to play it live, I'm going to play it in a club one day, or both?
Neither. I'm composing music like I'm doing my prayer or some kind of spiritual things, you know. I'm just composing music because I feel good when I compose music.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And there is no purpose behind it. It's just an absolute. I like composing music.
Yeah.
And that's all. And it's always a problem to ask yourself, what can I do with the music and the period I'm living in? So now I can do album, I can do video, I can do SoundCloud, or I can do concert, but you know, it's work. And for me, music is not working. For me, music, it's being alive. It's something you feel inside.
I know your process is...
You're feeling good.
Your process with your machines is obviously flexible enough for you to... like, you remix a lot of your own tunes all the time, do different versions, you know, loads of different versions of the same song.
Yeah.
So, although when you're actually making it in the first place, it might not be about... But when you know you're going to be playing live, do you then try and do something a bit more... like a version that might be more friendly for people to, you know, you consider it. If you have a booking and you know in 6 weeks' time you're playing in Germany, you're thinking, okay, maybe I make a version which is...
I'm selecting maybe I think it's the more
driving tracks.
Maybe not the more hard-worn, but what I think it's the best to play. There is a lot of parts that are beside, and it's amazing the amount of parts I compose when I compose 1 hour of music for a live set, for example. In fact, it's maybe 4 hours of music somewhere in the machine that we'll maybe never get out anywhere or another.
We were talking earlier about 28 Days Later, and I had to do some commission work. Have you ever had to write music for a different purpose?
Yes.
Did you find it difficult then, or it's just because you're not used to it?
No, I don't find it. I find it.
Someone tells you what to make, like make me.
Surprisingly, I find it very easy. In fact, to compose things when I'm, you know, just stopping the idea of composing music from the stomach and the heart.
Someone gives you a style, thinking, and then it's easy. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's very easy, but the result, it's definitely something I don't like to re-listen. For example.
Yeah.
And I see all the stuff inside that are thought. Mm-hmm. So it's I don't like it. In fact. But I think, you know, composing music for something, and in particular for the people, it's like a tyranny, especially nowadays. Because if you're composing, I'm not saying speaking like you're composing a music for your girlfriend or your friends. I'm speaking about composing music for a crowd or for a scene or for a particular, and it's really a tyranny for me. Like normally for me in my world, you're composing the best music you can with the most honest attitude, and then you bring these kids, this child to the world, and in the best way possible, sure, but it's the heart. It's not supposed to be like you say in English, it's like the TV show. It's not a TV show, right? It's not an entertainment, it's music.
Yeah.
So it's difficult for me to look back, to select, certain parts.
You mean it's not entertainment for you or for the... You're talking about you're taking your music seriously, but... Because obviously music is entertainment for the end user, for the listener.
It shouldn't.
Because you're entertaining them.
No, I hope not. Entertaining for me in French, it's getting lost in a false way. You know, music, it's not this, it's transcendental.
Or maybe is this something lost in translation then? So it's not necessary. Entertainment in England is just something that's occupies you for your own enjoyment.
Yes, but it's occupying without the most important aspect. You know, in French, it's divertissement. And divertissement means there's the way and you try to get the people away from the good way. So there's this two meaning. You can want to advertise or entertain yourself in a good way, but you can also be being lost into something that is not relevant, something that is not important, like being not alienated, you know? And music is something that's supposed to free your mind, free the people. And being an entertaining, composing an entertaining music, it's something that keep the people into the alienation. You have to shock people. You have to hit people with something that is at the same time beautiful but very new. So it's difficult at the first impression. And you are
But their entertainment could come from that feeling of shock. Maybe it's just because it means something different in English than in... Maybe this is the only thing.
Maybe it's too low for French, the French world. You know, you cannot be entertained, and at the same time, you cannot be like revolution. It's not possible.
No,
you cannot be diverti, and at the same time, enrichi.
Yes.
What is your next step now?
I have many.
What can we expect for?
Well, yeah, some I can't talk about, but there's plenty in the pipeline. I will be releasing a record on Kaer-uiks. You'll find out more about it soon. I can't say much at the moment, but hopefully that'll be out for the summer. I'll be doing something for the wonderful Daniel Glazer and kaer-uiks. Is this how you say it?
I know what you mean.
I'm sure you don't know yourself.
Daniel.
If you don't know them,
how do you? Yeah. You pronounce.
If you don't know them, check them out anyway. Fucking seriously, cool guy, great designer, cool music taste, generally cool. So we're doing that, and my. Two albums, my album of like music as in more real instruments, if you want to, like piano, guitar, strings, vocals, this sort of instruments, analog, I don't know even what you call them, old-fashioned, whatever, these sort of instruments. And then the Flint Kids debut album, which, whether albums are still relevant or not, is it worth doing? Or should I just release fucking six singles instead? I don't know. We'll find out. I want to do an album. I want to do two albums at once. One electronic and one not so electronic. But I know that there's going to be plenty of electronic creeping into the other one. So I really don't know. I'm just going to enjoy writing music, see what happens, and I'll just know when it's good. I'll listen. And if I, basically, everyone's their own harshest critic. So if I think it's good, then it probably is good, because normally I'd be very hard on myself. So I'll just keep on making music until I think, okay, I will be happy for this to go into the ether. And yeah, so two albums. I never know what phone call is going to be next for, like, my freelancing or work. Obviously, I'd like to do something else for Secret Cinema in the future, because that was a great project and some really inspirational people to work with. Obviously, in the future, we're going to do some Max crazy shit together.
Some Flint Kougaï.
Yes, this sort of stuff.
Could happen.
Indeed, FK. Haven't even got to change it. Flint Kougaï. Still the FK. This is good. And I'm sure whiskey will be in there somewhere as well.
Some ether.
Yes, yeah. The real ether. Yeah. Anyway.
Flint.
It's been fun, man. Thanks.
Yes, it's been a pleasure.
Thanks for having me.
And maybe talk more about how things developed.
Yes.
In the future. Yes.
When you stay at my house in London.
Yeah.
We have interview part two in FKHQ. There we go.
That's a deal.
Indeed. Cool. Over and out.
Cheers.
An evening with Syl Kougaï. It's nice. It's like a week. It's like MTV. An evening with Syl Kougaï. Nice relaxed chat with friends.